walking on the road to Jerusalem. The time had come to sacrifice again. My two small sons, they walked beside me on the road. The reason that they came was to watch the Lamb. Daddy, Daddy, what will we see there? There's so much that we don't understand. So I told them of Moses and Father Abraham. And then I said, dear children, watch the Lamb. For there will be so many in Jerusalem today. We must be sure the Lamb doesn't run away. I told them of Moses and Father Abraham. And then I said, dear children, watch the Lamb. Now when we reached the city, I knew something must be wrong. There were no joyful worshipers, no joyful worship songs. I stood there with my children in the midst of angry men. Then I heard the crowd cry out, a part I did not wish to play. Why upon this day were men condemned to die? Why were we standing here where soon they would pass by? I looked and said, even now they come. First one cried for mercy, the people gave him none. The second one was violent, he was arrogant and loud. I still can hear his angry voice screaming at the crowd. Then someone said, there's Jesus. Scarce believe my eyes. A man so badly beaten, he barely looked alive. Blood poured from his body, from the thorns upon his brow, running down the cross, falling to the ground. I watched him as he struggled. I watched him as he fell. The cross came down upon his back. The crowd began to yell. In that moment, I felt such agony. In that moment, I felt such loss. Until a Roman soldier grabbed my arm and screamed, "You! Then his hand reached for his sword. And so I knelt and took the cross from the Lord. I placed it on my shoulder and started down the street. blood that he'd been shedding was running down my cheek. They led us to Golgotha. They drove nails deep in his feet and hands. And yet upon the cross I heard him pray, Father, forgive them. Oh, never have I seen such love in any other eyes. Into thy hands I commit my spirit, he prayed, and then he died. I stood for what seemed like years. I'd lost all sense of time until I felt two tiny hands holding tight to mine. My children stood there weeping. I heard the oldest say, Father, please forgive us. Ran away. Daddy, Daddy, what have we seen here? There's so much that we don't understand. So I took them in my arms. We turned and faced the cross. Then I said, dear children, watch the Lamb.
Christ be magnified. stand strong and worship you. If that puts me in the fire, I'll rejoice because you're there too. I won't be formed by feelings. I hold fast to what is true. If the cross brings transformation, then I'll be crucified with you. Because death is just the doorway into resurrection life. If I join you in your sufferings, then I'll join you when you rise. When you return in glory with all the angels and the saints, my heart will still be singing, my song will be the same. Oh, Christ be magnified, let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified, let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me.
Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph, and my God will never fail. Oh, my God will never fail. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. There's power in the mighty name of Jesus. And every war he wages, he will win. And I'm not backing down from any giant, cause I know how this story ends. Yes, I know how this story ends. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. 'Cause I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. Yes, I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. Yeah, I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good.
Jesus washes me, and
know the blood of Jesus shed for me. And what a sacrifice that saved my life. Yes, the blood, it is my victory. And oh, the blood of the Lamb. And oh, the blood of the Lamb. And oh, the blood of the Lamb. The precious blood of the Lamb. And what a sacrifice saved my life. Yes, the blood, it is my victory. And no, what love, no greater love. Grace, how can it be that in my sin, yes, even then, he shed his blood for me. Oh, the blood of Jesus washes me. And oh, the blood of Jesus shed for me. And what a sacrifice that saved my life. Yes, the blood, it is my victory. And what a sacrifice that saved my life. Yes, the blood, it is my victory. I called you inside. be lifted high in our love. Be lifted high in my life. Be lifted high in our world. Be lifted high in our love. Be lifted high in my life. Be lifted high in our world. Be lifted high in our love. Be lifted high.
I'd like to read one verse to you from the book of John, which is actually the book that you have been reading off the screen this evening, the crucifixion account. I'd like to read you a verse that happens before that. It happens in John chapter 17. When Jesus finished saying these things, he looked up to heaven and said, "Father, the time has come. Glorify your Son so that the Son can glorify you." And this was an interesting verse. The first time I read it and I pondered it, I said, why would Jesus be asking for God to glorify him? And why would God need to be glorified? What's going on in this passage? And then I learned as I studied that the word glorify, it doesn't always mean exactly what we think in pop culture. The word glorify actually just simply means to lift up, to raise up. And so, like, if, from a physical sense, when I had kids and they were real small, right, babies or toddlers, and I would hold them over my head and they would giggle and laugh, I was glorifying my kids. I was lifting them up. Now, of course, we use that in different ways. When we compliment somebody, when we speak well about them, we do something for them, we would say we are glorifying them. We throw a great birthday party for them. We are glorifying. We are lifting them up. And so when we look at this passage, Jesus is saying this, Lord, I need you to lift me up because I need to lift you up. In fact, this tells us something about Jesus in this passage. It tells us that Jesus came for a reason and a purpose. His purpose was to glorify God, to lift God up. Why? Well, God had lost his place of prominence in so many of the people's lives. And Jesus came for a reason, a purpose. He said, I am going to be lifted up so that God can be elevated to his position in the lives of people, so that they would once again understand the prominence of God and how much God loves them and how much really that God wants to have relationship with them. They had lost sight of this type of thing. And so Jesus says, I come to be glorified, to be lifted up. And now he is saying, is the time. This is when it happens, God. In fact, Jesus is really saying, as we know later, all that would happen here with Jesus going to the cross, Jesus is saying, listen, I am willing, God, to go all the way with this, willing to do anything you need me to do. I will go even to the point of the cross so that I can glorify you, God, and so that these people can once again live in the relationship and the connection to you that you so desperately desire to have with them. That's a powerful verse when we read that. And so when we think now about the events of the crucifixion that you've been reading on the screen, that Jesus would be arrested, that he would be flogged and mocked, that the next morning he would carry his own cross as a kind of parade through the town, that eventually he would end on a hill called Golgotha outside the city, and he would be nailed to that cross, hands and feet, and then that cross would be elevated up, the base put in a hole, and there would be Jesus on the cross. And I can't stop but thinking of the imagery when I think of him being glorified and lifted up, that there's no way to think about that setting without thinking about it in the way of looking up at the cross and looking up at the suffering Christ on the cross. Jesus, in a very cruel, harsh, and really furious way from the religious leaders, is being glorified. He is being lifted up. And that's powerful. Why? So that God could be lifted up, elevated, put into his right place so that you and I could once again have that connection and relationship with him. We call it salvation. And it doesn't just happen in a moment when I say a prayer. It is something God comes into my life and wants to live in me and dwell in me the rest of my days. And then he gives me this gift of eternal life with him in heaven. That is why Jesus is glorified, elevated on the cross. And I wonder in the story if maybe those who saw him raise Lazarus from the dead just a week before in the town of Bethany, some followed him to Jerusalem, but what about the ones that didn't? What about the ones that saw Lazarus raised from the dead, were amazed, but they went on back to their houses? Or how about the crowd in Jerusalem that came out because the people from Bethany were shouting and saying amazing things about Jesus? They came out to see Jesus, and I wonder if some of them said, "Nah, I'm not interested." Or what about the ones that maybe came to the Palm Sunday parade and they waved the palm branches and they said, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." And yet then they went on back at the end of their parade. They just went back to their house. That was a good day. That was fun. But they weren't ready to do anything more with Jesus. Or the ones that sat or stood with the religious leaders and heard them shout, "Crucify him, crucify him." Maybe they were even swayed where they got mixed up in that. Or maybe they thought, this doesn't sound right, but they went on back to their homes. I wonder if you see yourself in that. That Jesus has ever touched your life, that God's ever kind of called you and you know it and he's doing something and you said, "This is amazing, this is neat." But then you just went on back to your own life, to do your thing, whatever it was. I can't imagine that the person that was willing to follow him all the way through that parade of a cross up to Golgotha to see him being glorified and lifted up on that cross, that their lives would not be impacted and changed because of Jesus' glorification that day. And so I invite you, I ask you tonight on this Good Friday, as we reflect again on the cross, would you revisit the cross? Would you revisit what Christ did, his willingness to go all the way with this, that we might have right relationship with God? Would you revisit that? Would you spend time this evening even opening your Bible and looking towards the end of the Gospels? If you're not sure where to go, just look towards the end and you'll start to see this arrest, crucifixion type headings or talk. Read in there and revisit the cross. In that, Christ being lifted up on the cross, He desires for God to be elevated in your life. And this is a night you could do that. It's a night you could simply say, God, I need you. I need you. Jesus, come into my life. Be the Lord of my life. I elevate you to the prominent position in my life. It'll be a starting point. You'll have a lot to learn and grow. That's okay. God wants to take you on that ride and journey. Would you tonight do that? If tonight you need to do a resurrender of your life, would you revisit the cross and would you do that? Now, Sunday, we're going to celebrate the resurrected Christ because really the crucifixion means nothing without the resurrection. But tonight, would you reflect on the cross, the power and the impact it has on your life? Let me pray for you. Father, would you renew once again in us how significant and powerful your act on the cross was? Father, would we be in awe once again, and would we look at you, and would we understand again that you are in a very real way, in a way that you self-declared, you are being glorified, lifted up. And Father, would we not waste the opportunity to take the significance of that and let you be elevated to the place of prominence in our own life tonight, we pray. In your Son's name, amen. Amen. The Lord bless.
Good evening. My name is Pastor Anson, and I just want to thank you for joining us for our Good Friday services tonight. If there's any part of the message that spoke to your heart, if you have questions about a relationship with Christ, if you have not experienced a relationship with Christ, we'd love to answer any questions that you might have. Just reach out to Windover Hills Church, and we'd love to talk with you about that. And hey, if you're in the Jamestown area this coming Sunday, we'd love to have you for our Easter Sunday services. They're going to be outdoors here at Windover Hills Church, and we'd love to have you. Bring a friend, bring a chair, and we'd see you there.